Crooked soul.
Thank you.
worship and valuing the Lord Jesus Christ, that your singing today is going to be a little more uplifted, right? As you think about what Christ has done for you and think about these words that reflect that, hopefully the Lord finds grateful hearts, hearts that are making sacrifices of praise to the Lord. And so we want to do that. We're going to sing a few more songs here this morning. Before we do that, I want to have a word of prayer. Not just because that's what we do, but because prayer is important. And we have some things that we need to pray about, of course, for this service. But also heard from the Whitcombs this morning, and Brother Frank is having some real health issues. And I don't know how much Myrna really wants to have out there, but they're actually driving him to Fargo right now because he has some pretty serious, I mean, something that they can't do here in Park Rapids. And if he doesn't get it taken care of, like, now, then it can be really, really, really serious in the days ahead. And so if you pray for Frank, as I pray, for him, pray for Myrna too. She's such a sweet lady. She feels everything, but she especially feels when Frank's not well. And he seems like he's in good spirits, but needs your prayers. So let's pray for that, if you would. Lord God, thank you for the awesome privilege of prayer. Thank you for allowing us to bring to you what we need. And Lord, we need so much. We're more than we could ever pray and ask for in a whole week. Lord, we're not even aware of all of our needs, but we know that we need you. And we admit this morning, Lord, that we are utterly dependent on you. Lord, right now as we speak, we can't affect any change in Frank's body. We can't do anything for him, but you can. Lord, you're there with him. You've gone ahead and you've given the doctors wisdom. We pray, Lord, that what is going on will be taken care of right away, that there would be no long-term ill health problems from this, that you would encourage Myrna to build the faith of the Whitcombs, use this in the life of their children and grandchildren to bring yourself honor and glory. And we're asking, God, that you would just put your hand on Frank, Lord, and make it so that this is healed and taken care of, Lord, even before they get to the hospital. That would be such a blessing to hear, Lord, that you've done that. We don't know what your will is, but we do ask, Lord, that you would heal Frank. And then, Lord, for our service, we're asking that you would meet with us, that you would speak to us personally, that the Holy Spirit would have the freedom that he needs to work in lives to make us more like Jesus Christ and to help us grow in grace. And so, Lord, to that end, we ask your blessing and help in Jesus' name. Amen. Remain standing as we sing number 624. Count your many, 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 many blessings. Number 624. 65. You can be seated as we sing all three verses of Let the Lower Lights Be Burning, number 625. Lord, thank you for the ministry they've had in Spain. Lord, thank you for sending them and their children to work with them in the field. Thank you, Lord, for this new ministry opportunity they've had in the seminary. We're asking, God, that you would give them strength this week. Lord, if they try to minister among COVID, Lord, we know that it hit Spain really hard, and for a while they weren't able to do much of anything. We're asking, God, that you'd give them innovation, that you'd give them wisdom to know how to reach out. Lord, that even maybe as they're not able to reach out, that you'd give them a time of rest and a time to think about their ministry and to know exactly what your will might be. Lord, we pray for Brother Larry as he recovers from his knee surgery. We ask, Lord, for complete healing for him. And again, that the gospel might be proclaimed broadly in Toledo. Lord, help the parks this week. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. A few announcements. Tonight, we're at 6 o'clock, we'll have a service. We'll have a blessing and testimony time. And then I'm going to be preaching out of Proverbs 16, verse 9. And that is, a man's heart deviseth his way, but the Lord directeth his steps. So it's something I'm going to touch on this morning in the message, but tonight preaching on that. It'll be, I guess, more devotional thoughts this morning and tonight. But look forward to meeting with us tonight at 6. This coming Wednesday, we're still going through Titus. We're in Titus 2, finally. And so looking forward to that. Then next Sunday night, The plan is right now, and again, this already changed, but the plan is right now to have a missionary with us. David Bickers, missionary to Thailand, is going to be with us, with his family, next Sunday night. I'm still trying to confirm that. It was just kind of a last-minute thing, but I just got some confirmation this morning, so I need to reach out back to him. But that's the plan for next Sunday night. If you pray about what the Lord would have you give in way of a love gift. Thank you to everybody who gave last week for the missionary family we have. We're able to give them a great love offering. And so thank you to everybody who did that. It was very last minute. It was my fault, but it was last minute for you to know. And you gave generously, and I appreciate that. Thank you to everybody who's been giving. In light of COVID, you know, you don't know if people, sometimes with people, if they're not here, you know, kind of out of sight, out of mind, but you as a church have been so faithful in giving to the Lord and generous in supporting the various ministries, and that's a testimony to the Lord's work in your life, and I'm thankful for that. We have a few other things I wanted to bring up. One is that it's July, and so we have those devotional booklets on the back table. I don't know, Brother Bob, how many of those do we have left? Probably not many.
We have two.
Two left. Okay. So, if you'd like to have one, if that's been a help to you, if you're not in the regular habit of reading your Bible, that devotional booklet might just kind of put you on that right path. There's usually a little devotional thought and some scripture reading, and then that'll help you just kind of stay on track. Some of you are going through the Bible in a year through our things, and some of you just, you know, you go through Psalms, you go through whatever it is. However you're reading your Bible every day, read your Bible, okay? That's great. I'm not trying to get you off of your plan. But if you don't have a plan, that devotional book might help. And if we're running out every year, every month, we might just have to order some more, right? So that would be all right. I just don't want to throw any away, you know? The other thing is that back on the white table, there are some cards out there. So what that is, I'm a chaplain for the sheriff's office and for the police department, one of a few, and as you know, there's been a lot of anti-police sentiment in our country. I feel like not so much around here, but whenever there's anti-police sentiment, police officers feel that, right? Just like when there's anti-Christian sentiment, you feel that, right? And so I felt like it would be good. I put out an email message to all of the Shield 616 prayer sponsors. And if you don't know what that is, basically Shield 616 is an organization that helps churches and Christians get gear that they don't have for officers. And a few years ago, a group of people, Christians in our area, were able to purchase helmets and bulletproof vests that they couldn't get otherwise to all of the deputies and officers in our area. But with them then also was a person that was committed to praying for them every day and praying for and investing in their lives. And so I put an email out to all those people to say, hey, would you just go get a pack of cards and write a note to the police department or the sheriff's office or both and just tell them how much you appreciate them, how much you are grateful for them being there, and then give three to other people that they can pass out. I thought, well, I can probably do better than what I'm asking other people to do. So I have a whole bunch back there. If you just take a couple, and you don't have to write to any officer in particular, you can if you want, if you know some of them, but just to be able to write it and inundate the office with cards saying, hey, we see what you're doing, we appreciate you, we know that there's bad cops out there, there are people that don't do right, just like there are in any profession, but we appreciate everything that you do. And I can personally vouch, I've been on hours of ride-alongs with the officers, and they do a fantastic job. They treat people with respect. There hasn't been any kind of racially motivated brutality. I feel like they're a lot kinder than I would be if I were an officer. And so I can again say that I can personally vouch for them, and Seth can too. So it might just be something that you don't have to do it, but if you'd like to, it'd be an encouragement. The cards are back there. You can either take it home, put a stamp on it, or you can just throw it in the basket and I'll take it over there so they have some way to know that there are Christians who are supporting them, who are encouraging them. Feel free to put a Bible verse in there or something, or whatever you want to do, but I would encourage you to do that. Gentlemen, come forward please to receive the offering. And again, if you're watching online, there are different ways to give there as well. Thank you to everybody who has been given. Brother Bob, can I ask you to ask the Lord blessing your offering?
Holy Father, we just thank you for all your many blessings, Lord. We just ask your blessing on our service, Lord. Be with our pastor as he preaches your word to us. And just change and we draw closer to you because of the preaching of your word. And Lord, we just would ask a special blessing and tithe and offer, Lord, that it be used for your glory. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Marching on, marching on, for Christ's sake.
chapter 3. Proverbs is a great book talking about the way of God, the paths, the word ways, paths. That word is found quite a bit in Proverbs, and that's the whole point of Proverbs. He's trying to get his son to understand that the way of God is the way we should follow. And there are a lot of ways that you can be distracted from the way of God. Don't get distracted by those things that Satan would have you try to get off, but try to stay on the path of God. That's the whole, one of the points of Proverbs. And so we'll read a passage that talks about this. Proverbs 3, verses 1 through 7. My son, forget not my law, but let thine heart keep my commandments. For length of days and long life and peace shall they add to thee. Let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them about thy neck. Write them upon the table of thine heart. So shalt thou find favor and good understanding in the sight of God and man. I wonder if you'd read verses 5 and 6 aloud with me.
Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thy own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths.
And then finally I'll read verse 7. Be not wise in thine own eyes, fear the Lord, and depart from evil. Okay, I've got to add his rich blessing to the public reading of his word. You may be seated. Are you all right, and children, if you'd like to, there is children's church for you. This is the one Sunday of the year where probably I'm going to hear from someone after church, you know, we really should invest in an air conditioning unit. Because this is about the only week that we need it. So now you won't hear me complain about this heat. You don't hear me complain about the winter, but I complain about the winter in private. So. All right. Now, hopefully you can stay cool. I am planning on, my message is probably a little bit shorter than normal. And so we'll try to be aware of that. And if you need to get up and get some fresh air or move by some fans, that's fine. I hope you can not let that be a distraction to you. We're going to Mark chapter 14. Gospel of Mark 14. This is the part where we are now turning from the teachings of Christ, the miracles of Christ, to what the gospel is all about, the passion of Christ, or the sufferings of Christ, the death, burial, and, praise God, resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's where we're headed now. And so the next few months will be all leading to that, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It would have been great if I could have timed this for the beginning of the year where we're going through Easter, but we'll have to have Easter again now, this year. We missed it this year, so we'll do it again. But anyway, I am, if I can get, and I don't know if I can or not, but if I can get individually wrapped grape juice and bread, they sell them in little packets. If I can get some of those this week, we'd like to try to do that next Sunday. You're not supposed to be serving food in church, but if it's individually wrapped, then we could do something like that. We'd like to do the Lord's Supper next Sunday morning, if I can get all of that together, okay? So, just plan on that, because we're going to be talking about the Lord's Supper next week, but we're talking about getting ready for the Lord's Supper this week. And so, Mark 14, let's read verses 12 through 17, and then I'll pray, and then we'll get into the message. In the first day of unleavened bread, when they killed the Passover, his disciples said unto him, Where wilt thou that we go and prepare that thou mayest eat the Passover? Verse 13. And he sendeth forth two of his disciples and saith unto them, Go ye into the city, and there shall meet you a man bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him. And wheresoever he shall go in, say ye to the goodman of the house, The master saith, Where is the guest chamber where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he will show you a large upper room, furnished and prepared. There make ready for us.
And his disciples went forth and came into the city, and found as he had said unto them, and they made ready the Passover. And in the evening he cometh with the 12. Lord, now as we look into your word, a few simple truths, we're asking God that you would make this come alive to us, that you bolster our confidence and trust in you, Lord. You're a God who's worth trusting. You're a God who, when we depend on you, Lord, our dependence is well placed. Help us to glory in you and your dependability. Help us, Lord, to acknowledge the paths that you have set for us in our lives. And I pray, Lord, that you be honored and glorified in yourself in this message. Lord, please help me. You know my deficiencies, Lord. You know all of the distractions that are available to us that Satan would love us to focus on. Pray that that would not be allowed, and that the Holy Spirit would reign supreme here in our midst here this morning. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen. When America declared independence, the British were not going to simply let that go, obviously, right? Obviously. They started to draw battle plans for how they were going to bring the colonists back under subjugation, and they planned a short little war to quash the rebellion. But, as history has now borne out, really, there was a lot of poor planning involved in the British plan to quash the American Revolution. One of those things is that they were very much used to, that their soldiers were very much used to bayonet charges. So it used to be that soldiers would line up and they would shoot and then they would come at each other, and most of the killing happened with bayonet charges. And so that's what the British were used to. What they didn't count on were the fact that all of these colonists would hide behind trees and pick them off. They were good shots. They had to be, because they were shooting their own food. And so that in and of itself made things very difficult for the British, and they weren't planning on that. Their men weren't as good as shots. Another thing was that their whole plan was, well, if we can take American colonist cities, then the colonists will fold. And so they spent a lot of time and attention, for instance, General Howe, trying to take the city of Philadelphia, thinking, well, once we do that, it's the capital, everything will fold. But they took Philadelphia with heavy casualties, and the Congress and all the leaders of the revolution just left. And they didn't really win anything, and the colonists fought on. Then, near the end of the war, Cornwallis wasted men at Guilford Courthouse, and with the heavy casualties, won part of the war, but had such heavy casualties that as he was waiting for reinforcements, retreated to Yorktown, and as he was waiting, George Washington came in. And of course, we understand that's where he surrendered his army. The more you understand about how our country came to be, it really should not have happened. I mean, Great Britain had a great army and the best navy in the world. There's no reason why it should have worked. And when you look at it, we really are a God-blessed nation. Now you say, well, Pastor, do you believe that we're a Christian nation? Well, there are Christians in our nation, just like there are Christians in every nation. I would say that inasmuch as we follow Judeo-Christian values and we base our laws upon them, we could be called a Christian-ish nation. I think we're far away from that now. Yeah. I don't think we're ever meant to be a theocracy, if that's what you mean by a Christian nation, but I'm thankful for the Christian heritage that we have had. Does that mean that every founding father was a Christian? No, that's not true. But they had at least a basis for their morality and ethics, the Judeo-Christian, biblical worldview. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 9 says, "A man's heart deviseth his way, but the Lord directeth his steps." And again, that's the passage I'm going to preach tonight, but the idea of the passage is that we make plans. Right? We think about what we want to do, but God has his plans. And as we're making plans, God directs our way. How can God do that? Well, God can do that because he knows the future. See, we often make plans with some regard to what might happen in the future, but we don't know the future. I mean, if you knew the future, you'd make different decisions today, right? If you knew the stock market was going to crash on Wednesday, you'd probably do something about that, right? Problem is that we don't know. We make assumptions and we think, well, it's going to go this way, or life is going to continue after this whole COVID thing. Yeah, maybe. Maybe not. We don't know. I'm not trying to scare anybody. I'm just trying to say, God knows the future, so His plans are actual plans. Our plans are really just best guesses, right? Inaccurate guesses. God can make plans because He understands consequences. See, we say, well, if I do this, then this will happen. But God understands that sometimes when you do this, what you think is going to happen, actually the opposite happens. And you probably had things like that in your life, right? Oh yeah, this is what I'm going to do. It's going to work out great. And it doesn't, because you didn't. You were thinking in, you know, very one set terms. God can plan because He can actually make things happen. We're very much subject to outside forces. God is subject to no outside force. And God's plans work because His are based on right desires. Often we make plans because what we want, we feel like will help us. But in being very selfish, God has to sometimes fight against us. God's plans are always based in right desires. And so there's this conflict when we understand about making choices and making decisions and understanding that with the understanding also that God is a sovereign God that can get whatever God wants, right? So there's this debate between the free will of man and the sovereignty of God. And I understand that those things are hard to reconcile at times. It feels like they're the two cogs of different teeth. I'm not going to wade into that much this morning. I'm going to a little bit tonight. But God is able to get what He wants, even in sinful choices. And nothing is beyond God's control, knowledge, or planning. So again, in our passage here, we're heading into the Passion. We turn a corner in the narrative, and it's hard to think about God's plan and God's will in light of the crucifixion. Right? I mean, just think about it in this term. Was it God's will for Jesus to die on the cross? Did it make God happy that Jesus died on the cross? Well, what's God's will if it doesn't make God happy? Right? There's a lot. It's really complicated, isn't it? Was it God's plan for Jesus to die on the cross?
Yes.
But did He have to use sinful people to do it? Yeah. Even while warning them to not make those sinful choices. So it's really complicated. And that's okay. Right? There are things that Christians can wrestle with, and things that we can't always explain, because, I mean, it's God. Right? How do you explain God? The end of Romans 11 says, you know, the depth of finding out. You can't find it. You know, the God's ways are beyond our ways. But as we reflect on our own life and reflect in the way that God moves in our own choices and in our own path, hopefully there's some things here this morning that will look, that will help answer the question, where is God in the midst of planning? Our planning, hard things that we didn't plan for. What can we learn about God's way from this story? So again, this is a very simple story, one that you'd be tempted just to move over. In fact, early this week, I was just going to lump this passage in with the Last Supper and even go into where Peter's betrayal and lump it all in one story. And the more I studied it, the more I felt like the Lord is really leading to just focus on this one story. It's the story we read, verses 12 through 17. And I want to draw out some truths from this. One is that God has circumstances ready. So as you look ahead into the future that you don't know about, understand that God has circumstances already ready. Verse 12, the first day of the unleavened bread, when they killed the Passover, His disciples said unto Him, where wilt thou that we go and prepare that thou mayest eat the Passover? Now again, the Passover was instituted in about 1400 B.C. So this is many, many years before. And from that time, from the birth of the Jewish nation all the way until now, at the 14th day of Nisan, the Jews celebrated Passover. And there were certain things that they had to... What it was their Independence Day. It was the day that they got freedom from Egypt. And it was a way that God had delivered them. So there were certain things they had to do for this feast. It wasn't just, you know, take a moment to remember. It was, you have to get a lamb of the first year and roast it. Don't boil it. And you have to get bitter herbs, which was, you know, horseradish or some really strong onions, something that would make you kind of, ugh. Get some unleavened bread, get all the leaven out of your house, and that was your meal. It was a very different sort of meal. And again, if you've been with us when we do our Christian Seder, you understand some of the symbols that are there and what it kind of morphed to. From the best evidences that we have, in Jesus' day, they had already gone into the part where they had four little cups of wine. So somebody's got to get all that ready, all the wine ready, all the bread ready, all the bitter herbs ready. Everything's got to be set up. And so these disciples ask, where do you want this to happen? And so Jesus says in verse 13, he sendeth forth two of his disciples and saith unto them, go ye into the city of Jerusalem, and there shall meet you a man bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him. Okay, that's the first step. Right? So where do you want us to eat the Passover? We're not from Jerusalem, we're from Galilee. Is there a place? I mean, we're kind of last minute now, but where are we supposed to eat the Passover? And Jesus says, go into the city and look for a man with a pitcher of water. Now, you wouldn't think that that's very strange, except that women did all the water carrying back in this day. So to see a man doing it would have been very, very strange. He would have stuck out. Right? You see this guy, and he's got a big jar on his shoulder, and he would have said, that's strange. And so Jesus said, when you see that guy, follow him. He's going to take you to the house that you need to go to where we're going to celebrate the Passover. All this had to do with the following of the house, the where, right? What are the circumstances of our celebrating the Passover? It'll be in this house. And the circumstances Jesus knew were going to be such that this man was going to be right as they went into the city, right where they needed to be. Sometimes things, and I'm going to put this in air quotes, happen to get us in the right way where God wants us. And just for a moment, take a reflection of your own life and things that just so happened, you might call them coincidences, that brought you to the place where you are now, where you're walking with the Lord. And looking back now, with the wisdom of the gospel, you understand that those things were not coincidences at all, that they were intentional. That God brought them into your life, the circumstances, the way that he moved was in your life in such a way to bring you to where you are now. Love to read stories about the Revolutionary War. And one of those stories I remember reading years ago, and I did a little more reading on it this week, was Washington had fought in the Battle of Long Island, in Manhattan, and had gotten stuck in Brooklyn. And the British were there, and instead of the British advancing, they stopped and they camped overnight, and General Washington realized he had just the night to get his army across the river into Long Island before the British would come. And so all night, again, they put cloth on their wagon wheels and on their cannon wheels. They put cloth on the oars, and they had some guys walking in front of the fires facing the British to make them look like there's still activity going on in the camp, but everybody was evacuated. And in the morning, when the British were supposed to come in, God sent a heavy fog. So there's fog everywhere, they couldn't see what was going on, and that allowed the very last one. Washington was the last one off the shore, under the boat, and everybody escaped, so that when Britain came into the camp, there was nobody there. Now, why did that happen? What a coincidence! There's no coincidence with God. There's a lot of different things in wars where you think, why did that happen? Why is it that Hitler decided to go into Russia? I mean, he could have done what he was going to do. He could have invaded England. But instead, he turned his sights and went into Russia in the cold. Why? Well, it just so happened that, I mean, you, as a Christian, you look at history and you say, that didn't happen just by accident. Right, decisions were made, circumstances were such where this happened for a reason. I was rehearsing with somebody this week or the week before. It was this week, when we first moved here. So we moved here to work in the church and learn from the pastor, and I didn't have any prospects. We didn't have a house. We'd sold our house, and we moved up here. And just as we get up here, we find out that we're going to have Evelyn. So I don't have a job. We have one child and one on the way, and oh no, right? So I'm looking for a job, and I looked in the paper, and I thought I saw an ad for a cabinetry place that was looking for help. And I had some woodworking experience. I've worked in cabinets, but I had some woodworking experience. So I thought, well, that would be neat. Anyway, so I'm going all over town looking for jobs, putting in my application. And as I'm driving somewhere, I notice a sign for a cabinet shop. And so I take the left turn, and I go in, I walk in, and I say, listen, I saw your ad in the paper that you're looking for help. Again, I couldn't remember the name of the cabinet shop, but I it was just weird that here I'm thinking about this cabinet shop, and here's a sign. And so I go in, and I'm like, are you looking for help? He said, well, it's funny you should say, I wasn't looking for help, but I was thinking about putting an ad in the paper, and if you're interested, show up on Monday. This is, I think, on a Friday or whatever. So I did, and that was one of the best jobs I've ever had. And it paid better than all the other jobs I was looking for. It just so happened that I was driving by, and that it just so happened that I'd seen that newspaper clipping, and it just so happened he was looking... No. See, here's the thing. As a Christian, you understand that circumstances happen for a reason. That God brings things. And it's not, again, the world says, well, yeah, stuff happens for a reason. You know? All these things happen for a reason. But we as Christians have something better. It's not just things happen for a reason. No. Our Heavenly Father makes things happen for our good. He brings in circumstances. He brings our attention to things so that the circumstances are right when we're following Him, when He has a plan for our life, that the circumstances that bring us to where we are now are from the Lord. And it's that mindset of looking for God's leading, looking for those circumstances. And again, it's throughout Scripture. Joseph, I was doing devotions with the boys this week, and we were reading the story of Joseph. And it's amazing to think about Joseph. So at the end of the story, Joseph saves Israel because he put all this food away and he was able to sustain them. You know, come to Egypt and I'll feed you. But how did Joseph get to the point where he was the second commander in all of Egypt and able to put all this food away? Well, it just so happened that he was sold into slavery. And it just so happened that he was sold into slavery to this guy that had a wife with a wandering eye. And it just so happened that she falsely accused him and he was in prison. Then while he was in prison, it just so happened that he was there with a butler and a baker. And it just so happened that they had a dream while they were there. And it just so happened that the butler was restored and that he just so happened to, 2 years later, remember that Joseph was there. And we as Christians say, baloney, it just so happened. God's fingerprints are all over that. There are no circumstances that are beyond God's control. We understand that God has circumstances ready. Walk into the city of Jerusalem, there's a guy holding a water pot. What are the chances that's the guy that we're supposed to follow? Well, if God's involved, pretty good chances. We don't even call them chances at that point, right? This is a certainty. God has circumstances ready. Doing devotions with the girls out of the book of Esther. And Esther, you know, she, for whatever reason, we're talking about this week, why is it that she, when she was asked, what do you want from the king? I'll give you half my kingdom. She says, twilight, you know? That 24 hours made all the difference in the world. What a coincidence. No, we understand that God's at work. You say, well, you know, sometimes things just happen. You can't read into everything. Well, I understand that. I understand that there are some people who get, you know, oh, why is it that this happened? I'm trying to think of a ridiculous... Have you ever had those? Thing where you're like, oh, that must be the Lord, and it totally wasn't. Right? I've had those before. You know, why is it that this song was playing on the radio? You know, you can't look into every single little thing. I'm just saying that having the mindset of God is working in your circumstances to bring you along your path. And God is clearing out your path for you. Again, as a believer, you understand that and understand God's ways are higher than your ways. God often works through circumstances when you're already following Him. If you're searching for His will, if the disciples are looking for a place to celebrate the Passover, what do they have to do first? Look for a guy with a pot of water. Right? For you as a Christian, I want to do God's will. God will put circumstances in your life to show you what He wants you to do. You will recognize it. And if you're trying to avoid sin, God will put big red flags on sins so that you can avoid it. I remember as a teenager, and I'm not going to get into all the details, but there was a woman who had our conversation just got very carnal. And it wasn't something I was necessarily trying to do, but in the midst of our conversation, where there was a proposition, the Lord brought into my mind some of the book of Proverbs. And it was like the Lord saying, whoa, hey, over here, right? Big red flag. And as you're walking with the Lord, as you're saying, God, I'm trying to avoid sin, the Lord brings in circumstances to show you how to avoid sin. That is one of the benefits of following the Lord, that you know where His will is, and you know what His will is not. And there are, I have learned in my life that there are, sometimes when you're going against something and there's resistance. Now sometimes you should persevere, you shouldn't just give up. But I've learned that often when there's a moment of resistance, learn to step back and say, all right, Lord, this is happening for a reason. What is it that you want me to know? And sometimes I'll see what it is. And sometimes I have to go looking. But sometimes, as soon as I take a step back and say, why is this so hard? Not that I'm, you know, I don't want any difficulty in my life. No, it's not that. It's just, why am I getting this resistance? And sometimes the Lord, in that moment, when you wait for Him, will reveal what's going on. Oh, it's a good thing I didn't get what I wanted. Because when I took a step back, God showed me. But it's learning that God works in the circumstances in your life. That He's working in the daily happenings in your life. You as a Christian can rest in the fact that God is working in your circumstances. That there is literally no such thing as an accident. And honestly, even things that have happened to you, circumstances that have happened to you that have been very painful, all of them are for your good. All of them are for your benefit. That's a hard thing for Christians to come to. We often think that, nope, if it's good, it's from God. If it's bad, it's from the devil. And the Bible just does not bear that out. God brings good in everything. Second, then, God has people ready. So John and Peter, they enter the house, and they're supposed to talk to the goodman, the owner. And when they go in, they find that the person has everything ready. God has people ready. So look at verse number 14. And wheresoever he shall go in, go in, say ye to the goodman of the house, the master saith, where is the guest chamber where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he will show you a large upper room furnished and prepared. There make ready for us. Okay, so I don't know this, but I've heard some good arguments that this boy with the water was possibly Mark, the one writing the story. Because, and the reason I think this is his mother's name is Mary, and later on in the book of Acts you find out that the church was meeting in Mary's upper room. And so this may have been. How did Mark know this story? Maybe because of that, I don't know. But as they went into this house, as Peter and John, they walk in and they say, the master says, where should we eat the Passover? Now, if somebody just walks into your house, you know, knocks on your door and says, the master's wondering where we're supposed to have supper, you'd be like, somewhere else, and shut the door, right? I don't know all of what happened here. Did Jesus talk to him beforehand? I don't know. But I do know that this man was waiting for his marching orders. This goodman of the house said, when the master calls, when the master sends his servants, I want to be ready. I want everything to be prepared. And so this man, God has people ready. All right, so getting to the house is one thing, but then you go to the house, and you're going to knock on the door, and you say to the goodman, this is really weird, but, I mean, you were supposed to say it boldly, the master saith, where shall we eat? The master's wondering if this is the place we're supposed to eat. Where, I mean, not if this is the place, but where in this place are we supposed to eat? And he says, oh yeah, I've been waiting for you. Come upstairs. God has people all over the world ready to do His will. There are people in your lives that are submitted to God, ready to do His will, listening for His voice. And again, if I can go back to the Revolutionary War, there was a man that if he had never been a part of the Revolutionary War, I'm not sure that we would have succeeded. And he wasn't an American, he wasn't a colonist. His name was Gilbert Lafayette. He was a Frenchman. And just loved revolution, loved war. Loved General Washington. And he came, and he's the one that when he went into Philadelphia to fight against Howe, he realized that some of the generals that were there, they weren't used to being in the army. It's not like the Civil War where you had some people that had already been in the army and now they were just split. Some of these colonists, they didn't know what they were doing, but Lafayette did. And he came and he helped them not get outflanked, and he helped them figure out what was going on. One thing, and I didn't realize this until this week when I was studying for this, Lafayette had been assigned a young black man named James Armistead. And this black man took care of his horse. And Lafayette used him as a spy. He said, go in and pretend like you're a runaway slave. And so he went to the British. And the British thought, this guy's perfect to be a spy for us. He can go back into the colonists and get information. So James Armistead came back, and he would tell Lafayette what they were doing, and then Lafayette would feed him false information to take back. One of the bravest things ever. And James Armistead, are there any statues about him? Do we even know about him? Amazing story. He helped figure out that Cornwallis was going into Yorktown so that General Washington could go in and surround him, and that's how they won the war, because of James Armistead. God has people there ready to do his will. And again, you think about things like Esther. Why is it that the king couldn't sleep? Well, the king couldn't sleep so that Haman could come in, and so, or the king couldn't sleep so that the records could be read beforehand, that the king could find out about Mordecai, and then when Haman came in, Haman could be the one to take Mordecai on a parade. I love that story, because it's just like God has people there in all the right places. Haman, you know, Haman, go and see the king. This is going to be great. Go see the king. You know, God has people in place throughout the book of Joseph. The butler who was there, who was going to forget about Joseph. Had he remembered Joseph right away, I don't think the story would have turned out like it did. Had it been somebody else, I don't think it would have turned out. If it would have been just the baker, it wouldn't have turned out the way it did. God has people ready. Well, you say, how does that work with people's free wills? Well, again, we'll talk about this tonight, but we're not as free as we think we are. We're open to a lot more suggestion, and I think we'd really like to admit. And if you don't think that's right, then just think about the last thing that you bought because you watched a commercial on TV. Right? We're much more open to suggestion than we like to think. And yes, we have free will, but let's not just pretend like it's a blank slate. We'll talk about this tonight, but we all have inclinations. God gives us choice, but he also knows how to convince us. Right? God knows how to make us do what he wants us to do. And he has a way of making those who follow him and those who are not following him do his will. Now, of course, it's easier for us who are submitted to God's will. We're obedient. We're waiting for him. So let me just challenge you this week. You may be one of those people that God wants to use in somebody else's life. And you're the goodman of the house. I mean, he's kind of the unsung hero, right? We don't even know the guy's name, but here he was. It was his house that they had the Last Supper, and they instituted this. And all that what happened in this upper room because of this man. Because he was willing to submit to the Lord. Because God has people in all places. Proverbs 11, verse 14, where no counsel is, the people fall, but in the multitude of counselors, there's safety. God wants to use you to help somebody else. You're one of God's people. You can be used to speak to others and be a blessing. Finally, then, God has resources ready. And the resource was this upper room. Notice in verse number 15, he will show you a large upper room, furnished and prepared. There, make ready for us. The word furnished means to be spread or to be strewn. So normally these upper rooms were used for storage. They would put all of their goods, all their dry goods, they would put maybe the mush for the wine up there. They would have, or they would just have extra stuff up there. And when the disciples came, it was all ready. It was furnished, it was everything, all the tables, all the chairs, well, they probably didn't have chairs, but they had like couches, all the bedrolls, everything was ready. And then it says prepared, it had been adjusted. The goodman of the house had spent time getting all these resources ready for Jesus. The colonists, one of their big needs in the American Revolution was gunpowder. And gunpowder came from saltpeter. And they didn't have any. And saltpeter is such, you have to let it soak for a long time, sometimes up to a half a year, to get all of the nitrous oxide out of it, or whatever, I don't know, I'm not a chemist, but there's some chemical in there you needed to get out, but it needed to soak for a long time, and the colonists didn't have a long time. The British had lots of gunpowder, but at one point in the war, General Washington went to find out how much can we get, and found out we can get a half a pound per man of gunpowder. And history tells us that when Washington found that out, he didn't talk for a half an hour, because he's trying to figure out, what are we going to do? It was the French and the Dutch who were willing to partner with the U.S. came to sell them the gunpowder. They had it already, and they were there to bring resources ready. And again, I really feel like that was of the Lord, that there were people ready to give and sell to the U.S. so that we could win the war against Britain. So you say, well, okay, so if all these things are true, if God has people ready and he has resources ready, then I guess he doesn't need me, right? If he owns the cattle on a thousand hills, and that's his business, right? Well, yes and no. God doesn't need you. God isn't dependent on you. God isn't hanging over the edge of heaven. Is so-and-so going to do the right thing? Oh, I really hope so, because otherwise my plan will fall apart. Obviously, God's not thinking that at all. But on the other side, God also is expecting you to be obedient to him and to be surrendered to him. Often, I find out in Scripture that God uses his people to supply his needs. I read in 2 Corinthians 8 and 9 all about there were saints in Jerusalem that were going through a famine, and the people of Achaia said, let's first give of ourselves and then give money to help the poor saints at Jerusalem. God was going to meet the need, but he did it through Christians, through churches. I read about in the Old Testament how God met the needs of Elijah, but how did he do it? Well, first, he brought bread with birds, ravens, right? They bring him bread. But then he went to the widow of Zarephath, where she took care of him. And she took care of him by, again, miraculous needs, but God always uses people to meet the needs. Could God make it so that all of a sudden, you know, some helicopter flying over your house drops exactly what you need in your yard? Sure he could. Nothing's beyond God. He just doesn't usually live that way. God has people that are ready, and the people that are people that are submitted to him are the ones who are going to make these resources ready. God fuels his work, and we need to follow his lead. Philippians 4:19 says, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. God will meet needs, right? We as Christians don't need to worry about that. What we need to do is depend on him. What we need to do is get to the point where we are totally dependent on him for his resources. Because nothing is beyond God. Now, it's true that sometimes we need to really ask, God, is this something you really want me to have? Or is this just something, you know, James 4, you'll consume it upon your own lusts. But you definitely have to wrestle through that. But don't ever think that that's beyond God to meet your needs. God has resources ready. What the disciples thought, what are we supposed to do? What are we going to do? We need to eat the Passover, but what are we going to do? No problem for God. Christ has circumstances ready. He has people ready. He has resources ready. This message is really meant to bolster your dependence on the Lord and to say, I want to walk with God so closely that not only do I want my own needs to be met, but I want to be used to meet the needs of others. Don't you love it when you act in obedience to the Lord and do something or give something or help somebody in some way, and they say, you know, I was just praying about that this morning. You know, I was just thinking I needed that. And isn't it awesome to be able to say, I was used by God. I was used as a tool of God to do his will. And he gets all the credit. But I feel pretty good about that, right? I don't know about you, but I want that to be like an everyday occurrence. I want it to get boring. You know? I'm being used by God to meet needs so much I just expect it all the time. That's what I want for my life, and hopefully you too. And Jesus' purpose was to eat the Passover with his disciples. And verses 16 and 17, it was already. His disciples went forth, came to the city, they found, as he said unto them, and they made ready the Passover. And in the evening, he cometh with the 12. Everything's ready. Now, John and Peter still had to go find it. They still had to go take the lamb to the temple, catch the blood, throw it on the base of the altar, take that lamb. They had to prepare it. They had to get the bitter herbs. But it was all ready for them to obey the word of God. And it'll be that way for you too. And again, the closer you walk with him, the more you hear his voice, the more you know. But even, praise God, even in times of disobedience, God is still working his will in your life to bring you closer to him. And so to that end, let's be looking for God's working and God's way in our life. Lord, help us, please, to be more attentive, more aware of your working. Lord, we know that you have a will for us. We know that you have a plan for us. And Lord, sometimes we find it. Sometimes we struggle. Sometimes we fight against you. And so we're looking, Lord, for the help that we need to find your will, to depend on you, to live in that faith that expects you to meet needs and doesn't just hope that you will. So Lord, help us, please. In Jesus' name.